classy when you are just born classy, as he obviously was. He just has a certain bearing and dignity about him.
I think he had three things that he's been interested in all his life, and that was his family, his work, and sports. I'm sure that he's still looking for a horse that's going to win a Triple Crown race.
And John Forsythe.
He was always busy. I said to him once, I saw him a TV show the other day. I couldn't believe it. You weren't in it.
Another job. Well done, Angels.
You somehow had the feeling from his voice that he watched over the Angels.
John was the strength of the show, and certainly the one that everyone went to when something went wrong.
John. He's just had such a long career. We worked with so many actors. He's just one of the very special ones.
In the early 1900s, Penns Grove, New Jersey was a lively small town with shopping, annual parades, and spacious homes. It was a good place for the newlywed Sam and Blanche Freund to begin their life together.
They're two very different people. My grandmother was very outwardly loving, giving, hugging, kissing. You know, she was absolutely terrific. My grandfather was equally terrific, but he didn't necessarily show it as much. But he was always the reserved one.
The couple's first son, John Lincoln Freund, was born on January 29th, 1918. The world would later know him as John Forsythe, but to his family, he would always be Link.
When he was born, his name was Lincoln Freund, and everybody in the family has always called him Link. And when he sends cards or, you know, notes or something, he signs it Link. So to us, he is just plain Link.
Blanche and Sam would have two more children, first Charlotte, then Donald. John's mother filled the house with her affection and humor.
But I knew his mother, and she was very warm and had a very big, sort of larger-than-life presence. Very ebullient, bubbly, and very loving. Very loving, but very large personality.
The thing that I remember most was that she always had time for us. She would take us on boat trips. She would take us to the beach. And there we had the sandwiches and all packed in a nice brown bag, and we'd go to the beach.
John's father traveled across the Delaware River each day to his job at the DuPont plant. Sam loved sports, especially baseball, and he passed his love of the game on to his son.
He'd take the sports department paper out and he'd throw it to me, say, "I'm home." And that was my introduction to sports. My father insisted that I knew everybody's name, every ball player's mother's name, shoe size, everything.
When John was 11, his father took a job on Wall Street and moved the family to Brooklyn. John soon became an avid Dodger fan. He even fantasized about becoming a sports writer. Forsythe was a regular kid. He liked sports, listened to his parents, and did well enough in school.
Well, I think it was quite a normal high school life. I wasn't spectacular. I wasn't downtrodden. I worked, and I got through my schooling exceptionally well.
John's parents assumed he would pursue a traditional career. So after graduating from high school, he headed to the University of North Carolina. Then in his junior year, John's life took a sharp turn, one that would take the avid baseball fan straight to Ebbets Field. A friend got Forsythe the job of special events announcer for the Brooklyn Dodgers. It was the first of several jobs that would make use of Forsythe's expressive voice. Before each game, Forsythe would describe novelty events, like champion athlete Babe Didrikson hitting golf balls into the outfield, or Olympic track star Jesse Owens racing a horse around the bases. For a guy who had grown up with the Dodgers, the job was heaven.
From listening to the stories, I always had the sense that this was one of the best jobs he ever had, that if it weren't for Linda Evans, this would outshine Dynasty, I think. because it was just so much fun for him.
Forsythe enjoyed performing for the crowd so much that he decided to give acting a try. His conservative father tried to talk him out of it.
He said, no, you should have stayed in baseball. He said, the hell with this acting stuff. He said, you don't need that. I said, why? He said, well, actors are funny people. They dress funny. I said, who are you talking about, John Barrymore?
One day, Forsythe saw an ad for a drama school that was overloaded with female students and now offered free acting lessons for men. Forsythe jumped at the opportunity. While there, he met and fell in love with one of the aspiring actresses, Parker McCormick.
She was a very interesting lady. She was lots of fun, very dramatic. She herself was an actress. She was a very enjoyable person.
Young and impulsive, the two decided to get married. They spent their honeymoon touring the country with a children's theater troupe. By the time the tour was over, Parker was pregnant with their first child, and the marriage was in trouble. The rigors of marriage and the carelessness of youth did not mix well. On February 14, 1941, John Forsythe held his first child in his arms, a son named Dal. However, even a new son couldn't mend the marriage, and the couple divorced after only 2 years together. But John still had to support Parker and Dal. A talent scout from Warner Brothers had seen him in a small part on stage and now offered Forsythe a contract. In 1943, he made his film debut as radio operator Sparks in the war film Destination Tokyo.
Captain is given permission to pick up the San Francisco newscast.
Destination Tokyo is a war film that was made by Warner Brothers in 1943 with Cary Grant and Dane Clark, made at a time when Hollywood was making a lot of kind of gung-ho war movies to inspire young kids to join the service and also to, you know, tell stories that people were thinking about in those days because everybody was, you know, so concentrated on the war and what was going on.
Come on, Sparks.
I got the record changer all hooked up, sir.
So I hear.
The crew certainly does appreciate your gift, sir.
And he had a very small part. Nobody particularly noticed him at the time, but you do notice it now when you see it because it's so clearly John Forsythe.
3 months after the premiere of Destination Tokyo, Forsythe became a soldier for real. He enlisted in the Army Air Corps. John turned down an offer to join the film unit and created a more meaningful assignment for himself. He drew on his experience as a remedial speech major to help traumatized soldiers recover their speech. With his time in service almost over, Forsythe was sent to New York to join the cast of Winged Victory, a Broadway production that raised money for the Air Corps. He wasn't alone in New York for long. An actress he had been dating in California, Julie Warren, now followed John across the country.
And my mother just fell madly in love. He was coming out of a very short-lived first marriage and didn't want to get married again. And he went off to New York to do a play, and she literally followed him across the country in a train.
Julie was a vivacious woman with a lovely singing voice. A day after her arrival in New York, she landed a major role in the Broadway musical Around the World in 80 Days. John couldn't resist Julie's spirit or the fact that she had a paying job, and in 1943, at the age of 28, he said, I do. Once again.
And they married on his day off, in his only day off, in the, because he was in the Army Air Corps, was Friday the 13th, December 13th.
And it turned out to be a marriage that lasted 50 some odd years. So it wasn't bad.
With my product, all I have to do is give a complete demonstration. If I do that, I've answered all six of the buyer's interests.
Forsythe now had to reestablish a career that had been interrupted by the war. With acting jobs scarce, he supported himself and Julie by acting in corporate films. But John wouldn't be playing frustrated salesman for long. He would soon make a name for himself in a major Broadway play. 29-year-old John Forsythe and his new wife, Julie, now settled in New York City. They thrived on the excitement of the city and eagerly pursued their acting careers. In 1947, John was invited to join a new acting school called the Actors Studio. It would later become the most famous drama school in the United States, legendary for the accomplishments of some of its alumni. Even in its first year, the Actors Studio attracted major talent. Forsythe found himself surrounded by students like Marlon Brando, actors who would define the rough-edged, realistic acting style of the 1950s. At the school, Forsythe, with his classic good looks and gracious manner, was known as the button-down bohemian.
And I was scared to death, so I never put my hand up, never offered anything for the longest while, for a year or two before I volunteered to do anything.
I think probably what helped him more than anything was the associations that he had there, the other actors he was meeting and the other, you know, future directors and all that that he was meeting at the Actors Studio.
The Actors Studio did help John get more substantial roles. In 1950, at the age of 32, he got his first big break on Broadway. He took over the title role of Mr. Roberts from Henry Fonda. He now had to convince the New York cast and the audience that he was as much Mr. Roberts as the well-known Fonda.
And the whole cast in New York, they didn't think anybody could come close to Henry Fonda. But after about three performances, they realized that John Forsythe was just as great.
I was afraid that things were going to be worse than they turned out to be. The cast couldn't have been nicer. They knew what the problems were. When you step into somebody's footsteps who were pretty big.
The cast accepted Forsythe enough to let him in on one of their rituals, a poker game that went on backstage during the show.
Because it was a cast of 48 guys, you know, and one girl. And so the guys, when we weren't on stage, we were downstairs playing poker.
John played Mr. Roberts for 18 months. He brought a sex appeal to the role of the Navy lieutenant that Fonda had not. Each night outside the theater, he was greeted by adoring female fans.
There'd be about 40 or 50 women waiting for him at the stage door, and they would all like sort of touch him. Oh, yeah, not just get an autograph, but they all would like touch his shoulder or something. Now, I had done it with Henry Fonda before that, and there were fans waiting for Henry Fonda, but there was all women waiting for John Forsythe.
But Forsythe left those fans behind each night and went home to his wife, Julie. When he began working steadily, the couple decided to start a family. In 1950, their first daughter, Paige, was born. Her sister, Brooke, arrived 4 years later. The success of Mr. Roberts helped Forsythe win another starring role on Broadway, this time in the Pulitzer Prize-winning play, Tea House of the August Moon. He played Captain Fishby, a bumbling American Army officer stationed in a small Japanese village. The play was a hit and packed the house for 4 years. The New York Times described his acting as genial and compared him to Henry Fonda. John occasionally took a break from the play to make a movie. In 1955, legendary film director Alfred Hitchcock cast Forsythe in his film The Trouble with Harry. It was an exciting opportunity for the young actor. The film was a macabre sort of comedy about a group of friends trying to hide the body of a dead man. Forsythe played an artist infatuated with Shirley MacLaine. He fit right into the Hitchcock tradition of handsome leading men.
I have witnesses, Sam.
Oh, I remember now. All right. You've got yourself a husband. I think I'll kiss you now to prove it.
If John Forsythe had been around, been 10 or 15 years younger, and he could have played opposite some of those grand ladies like Ingrid Bergman and Madeline Carroll and some of the Joan Fontaine, some of the great Hitchcock ladies of the 40s, he would have been a perfect Hitchcock leading man because he had that Cary Grant elegance and all of that. But by the time he worked for Hitchcock, Hitchcock was not at the top of his form and was not really the master during that period.
Hitchcock has called The Trouble with Harry one of his favorite films. but it did poorly at the box office and did not restore Hitchcock's reputation or catapult John Forsythe into the rank of first-run movie stars. The Tea House of the August Moon closed in 1955. Forsythe, now almost 40, had to figure out his next career move. After all, he had a family to support. A friend suggested that John try the relatively new world of series television. It would mean a steady paycheck and allow John and Julie to move back to her home state of California. Forsythe created a series that put a different spin on the family dramas so popular in the late 1950s, shows like Father Knows Best. He starred as a playboy lawyer named Bentley Gregg, who is suddenly given charge of a teenage niece. The series, called Bachelor Father, premiered in 1957.
Something wrong?
No, happy occasion. Vicky's getting married. She's leaving the office.
Oh, poor Uncle Bentley. Isn't that wonderful?
First time I ever heard anyone change moods in the same sentence.
I think it was perfect for John Forsythe to go into television when he did, because he was the kind of guy that you really like to welcome into your home every week and have around. Television was the great place for the gentler souls, and Forsythe fit into that perfectly.
Each week, Bentley Gregg courted a different beautiful woman. In one episode, Forsythe had to fend off the crush of a young actress who would one day play his wife in a glamorous nighttime soap opera. But in 1960, she was just a novice actress, grateful for his support.
He was very kind. I remember more working with him because that was even more stressful for me, because my mom had to be on the set because I was so young. And I didn't know what I was doing, and he was so helpful and so patient.
Though Forsythe played a swinging bachelor, on the set he was more like a typical 1950s television dad, benevolently dispensing advice and trying to be a role model.
John was always very supportive of me and taught me a few little tricks, like he taught me how to hit a mark without letting the world know that I was hitting the mark. And it was sort of like going to work, but it not really being work. It was more like fun. Sammy Tong used to say that we were a family, and he was the mother, and I was the baby, and John was the father.
The chemistry between the cast members helped make Bachelor Father a success for 5 seasons. During those 5 years, John Forsythe became a television star. And suddenly, he and his family found themselves caught in the publicity mill.
We had a lot of publicity photos taken at Disneyland, and we thought we were going to be with him on rides and things like that. And most of the time was doing publicity photos, and then the rest of the time he was swamped with people wanting autographs. So it was tough as a kid.
John and Julie were both trying to raise their daughters in as normal an environment as possible, given John's fame and their Beverly Hills address.
Our social circle was not Hollywood. We really grew up with normal people who went to public schools and had normal jobs, and he was very conscious. They both were very conscious of that.
John's son from his first marriage lived in New York with his mother, but Forsythe made sure that he remained a part of his life.
He was the kind of father who, after he had been divorced, managed to make real efforts, continuing efforts, to keep in touch with his son and include him in his family activities.
The end of Bachelor Father in 1962 did not mean the end of John Forsythe's career. Throughout the 1960s, he worked constantly. He starred in 2 other series, The John Forsythe Show in 1965 and To Rome with Love in 1969. Neither repeated the success of Bachelor Father. For his film work, Forsythe looked for parts different from Bentley Gregg and the other happy guy roles he so often played. In 1964, he appeared as a professor tormented by bad girl Anne Margaret in a movie with the irresistibly kitschy title, Kitten with a Whip.
Now there's only one down and one to go.
One down and two to go.
Aw, you can't get me mad now, lover. I'm free. Now we gotta just dump that drunk out along the road.
Are you crazy? I've gone this far, now where is that doctor?
Forsythe found a more substantial role in 1967 when he portrayed one of the detectives in the film adaptation of Truman Capote's chilling book, In Cold Blood.
I can believe one man might work up enough rage to do it, but two. Who would kill four people in cold blood for a radio, a pair of binoculars, and $40 in cash?
It was so far removed from what I was playing on the television series that it excited me and interested me. And it was a very rewarding thing to do. And a surprise for me. You know, people were surprised and said, oh, what's happened to Bachelor Father? So you always had to live that down.
John's next major role would return him to series television and introduce him, or at least his voice, to a whole new generation of fans. John Forsythe at 50 was that rare phenomenon, a steadily working actor. He had acted in films and on stage, but found his greatest success on the small screen. Besides appearing in many shows, specials, and movies, Forsythe also hosted a syndicated wildlife show called World of Survival. It seemed that whenever you turned on the TV, there he was.
He was one of those working people, like actors who work a lot. You know, I said to him once, I saw him a TV show the other day, and I couldn't believe it, you weren't in it. But it was almost like that.
And in 1976, television got much better for John Forsythe. One night, his friend producer Aaron Spelling called Forsythe. Spelling was in trouble. The actor he had hired to voice the part of Charlie Townsend in a new series called Charlie's Angels had arrived at the studio too drunk to say his lines. The finished pilot was due in 2 days, and Spelling asked John to come to the rescue.
So in my pajamas, I threw a raincoat on and went down on the bowels of 20th Century Fox with nothing but a microphone and two people standing, one being Aaron, another being the writer. So from 12:30, a quarter of one, till about 3 o'clock, we did it.
You heard that, Charlie?
Everything, Sabrina. And I've already made arrangements for you three to go to prison.
Prison? You've got to be kidding, Charlie.
When the pilot became a series, Spelling wanted Forsythe to be his Charlie. John was reluctant to take on a regular role, but Aaron Spelling could be very persuasive.
He said, listen, you can get a lot of money, a lot of money, if you do this. And I said, well, money's not the most important thing. He said, no, but you can get a lot of money. I said, all right, I'll do it. And sure enough, I did get a lot of money.
How does it feel to be out from behind bars, Angels?
Not funny, Charlie.
You somehow had the feeling from his voice that he watched over the Angels. And it made them feel safe and secure. And it made you feel safe and secure watching him, that you knew he would take care of them. Of course, Charlie could do anything with just his voice.
Well, your efforts are appreciated by a lot of people, including the governor. I received a call from him commending you on a job well done.
For 5 seasons, John greeted a changing array of angels over the speakerphone. He created a relationship with them using only his voice.
Oh, tell Bosley to forget Miss Hunter's billing. This one's on the house.
We didn't want somebody saying, okay, young ladies, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, I want you to do that. He had that little lilt, always opened up with, good morning, angels, and you liked him.
And he would come in, I think, whether it was every week, once a week, or once every 2 weeks, dressed beautifully, like a movie star. And he would do his 2 hours of voiceover. Then he would go to the Fox Commissary, and he would have a very elegant but light lunch, and then he would go to the racetrack. He was an old-time movie star.
Thank you, Angels. I wanted to tell you how much I appreciate you, care about you, and how much I'll miss you. I love you all.
Forsythe used some of the money from Charlie's Angels to indulge his passion for thoroughbred racing.
Second on the outside by Anak, Royal Champion, third.
And as a yearling, he was a little on the scrawny side, and you didn't have such high hopes for him, did you?
No, we really didn't. He was
for years, he had been a fan of the sport, and then he made the leap from fan to owner and breeder.
I notice he spends a lot of time in a stall with his horses. A lot of times after feeding time, you know, he's in there with that horse, and I don't know what goes on in there. I would hate to venture to say.
Many celebrities who get into horse racing soon learn why it is called the sport of kings. Thousands and thousands of dollars go out the window and don't come back unless your horse crosses that finish line in the top spot. John Forsythe had two secret weapons to keep his bank account in the black. His wife, Julie, who made sure that they never became what she termed overhorsed, and his deep knowledge of the sport.
You know, you start paying some bills after you own horses and you get very knowledgeable, or you either get out of the business. John is one of those kind of guys that finds out about everything he can about racing, and he's done it.
So many times you'll go out and ride a race and certain things will happen in a race. As a jockey, you'll have to come back and explain things play by play, why your horse got beat, why he got in trouble, why the pace didn't develop. John understood those things before you had to explain.
The winner is an extraordinary gentleman.
Now Forsythe began working at Hollywood Park Racetrack in Los Angeles as board member and vice president. Though one friend remembers John's time there differently.
John at Hollywood Park was in charge of washing cars. To see him out there in those little rubber boots and his rubber pants and he had his own chamois, a very expensive chamois that he washed cars with.
In 1979, all of John's activities suddenly had to be put on hold when he began feeling unusually tired. Within weeks, the fatigue worsened. Finally, he checked in with his doctor. A stress test showed that he wasn't getting enough oxygen to his heart. The condition would almost certainly lead to a major heart attack. John opted to undergo quadruple bypass surgery to correct the problem.
Well, it was very difficult the day that he had the surgery. You know, we realized that how much he was really the foundation of our family. And he went into the surgery, I think, frightened, but always feeling that he was going to be okay and that this was going to extend his quality of life and only, you know, enhance the quality of life that he had. And that's exactly what it did.
In a funny sort of way, it may have made him a little more tender-hearted. I think those things do that. They kind of open you up to emotions and feelings in ways that haven't been, you might not have otherwise, but it wasn't a big thing, but it just seemed like he was maybe even a little sweeter, you know, because of that.
Within 2 months, Forsythe was back out on the tennis court, and soon he returned to work. His first film role after surgery was anything but sweet. In the movie And Justice for All, he played a judge with a penchant for beating up women. His performance as a man with a distinctly evil side was satisfying for Forsythe and startling for his friends.
I see the wheel spinning. Sex photo, sex crime. Is he guilty?
Is he? Yes.
It was an interesting and provocative piece for me, because it was the first out-and-out bad guy that I had ever played. And some of my friends wouldn't talk to me after they saw the movie. They said, that's not you.
I remember going to see And Justice for All, where he played that really scoundrelly judge, and being totally shocked by him. I never thought I'd see my uncle doing anything like that.
And I think that he ultimately would have liked to have done more of that type of role where he really was outside his usual character, but it didn't happen as often as he would have liked.
And Justice for All paved the way for Forsythe to play another character in a role that would make him an international sex symbol at 60. In 1981, John Forsythe again received a phone call from Aaron Spelling asking for his help. The actor Spelling had cast as ruthless millionaire Blake Carrington just wasn't working out.
When we started shooting Dynasty, John Forsythe was not playing Blake Carrington. It was being played by an actor by the name of George Peppard, very good actor. We had been shooting for about a week, and it just wasn't going quite right. So I shut down the set, I called Aaron, and we sat down and said, well, what are you gonna do now? And Aaron said, let's get a hold of John Forsythe.
Spelling immediately contacted his friend Forsythe, who was out of town, and asked him to look at the script.
He said, do you like it? I said, do I like what? He said, do you like the script, the show? I said, yeah, I love it. He said, well, you don't have to send me a script, I'm doing it. And that's one of the nicest things an actor's ever done for me in my life. But that's John.
For Forsythe, the high-profile role offered a chance to reacquaint the public with the man behind the voice on Charlie's Angels.
When I was down in Atlanta about 3 or 4 weeks ago, a little lady walked up to me and she circled me 3 or 4 times. And she looked at me and she said, didn't you used to be John Forsythe?
Oh, gee.
And I freely confessed that I did used to be.
I love it.
But that meant, too, that not enough people really began to know me as an actor. They began to know me as a voice, and I thought I'd do something about it.
Dynasty reunited Forsythe with the actress who had appeared on Bachelor Father some 20 years before.
I had not seen him ever until the day he walked on the set of Dynasty and said, little Linda Evanstead, my, how you've grown. And I thought, how does he remember who I was from that long ago? Then he said, how is your mother, Arlene? And then I was really impressed.
John quickly made the role of Blake Carrington his own. He changed him from a cold-hearted tycoon to a hard-nosed businessman with family values.
I think he changed it for the better. It wasn't as obvious a character, a bad guy, but he made it much more complex and much more interesting.
What John did was he brought it to life. He made it live. He was the epitome of the wealthy, charming, but very good human being inside. And, you know, you can't write into a script what happens on screen when a specific or actor plays or an actress plays a part. They bring a part of themselves naturally to that part. John did that with Blake Carrington, and he did a magnificent job.
You're broke. Wiped out.
You heard him, Blake. You're finished. You've lost everything. And I now own this house.
This house? Are you insane?
Oh, no. I'm perfectly sane. So take this junk and your blonde tramp and get out of my home.
You are insane. This isn't your house, and it's never going to be.
Oh, you're so wrong. It's all mine, Blake, and I have the papers to prove it.
Papers? What papers? What are you talking about?
I bought all of your holdings, including this house. And there's absolutely nothing you can do about it.
Damn you, Alexis. I'm gonna kill you.
The excesses of Dynasty mirrored the extremes of the 1980s. Everything about the decade was excessive, and so was everything about Dynasty, from the shoulder pads to the ratings to the marketing of the series.
And the series, Dynasty, has launched a slew of consumer products, clothing lines, carpeting, and each of the lead characters has his own perfume.
My dearest Blake, I've had this fragrance created especially for you. I think it's as sexy as you are.
Forever Crystal and Carrington, both created to celebrate the love that lives forever.
At home in his mansion, Blake Carrington was the patriarch who was always there for his family. On the set, John played much the same role for the cast.
There was no doubt who was the quarterback on the show. From day one, it was John Forsythe. The cast looked up to him, they listened to him, and let me tell you this, if someone was late on the set, he would in his own dear way say, you know, that's not fair to our skinny boss.
I find myself in a strange kind of way, sitting on the set and feeling like this is my house, and how nice of all these nice people with the microphones and the cameras to come in and visit, you know, every day.
He got involved in every level. He really was very involved in the writing, in particular, to make sure things were cleaned up to a level that was comfortable for him in terms of quality, which we were all very grateful for, because he certainly came in with more power than any of us.
Crystal and Blake weren't popular just in the United States. Throughout the world, people were hooked on the outrageous doings of the Carrington clan. Bachelor Father had made John Forsythe a household name in America. Dynasty made him a sex symbol around the world. Not bad for a guy in his 60s.
I never saw him be pretentious. I never saw him try to put on. If he was a sex symbol, it was because the ladies thought so. You know, it wasn't John standing up and saying, hey, look at me. He never did that. He wasn't that type of guy.
It's very hard to not be classy when you are just born classy, as he obviously was. He just has a certain bearing and dignity about him. He would never be good in On the Waterfront. You know, he could probably act it very well, but he'd never be as good as Brando. But again, Brando would never be as good in Dynasty, no matter how hard he tried, because John Forsythe just brings a certain elegance to it.
By this time, John's wife, Julie, was used to dealing with her husband's sex symbol reputation.
John and Julie were good friends of ours, so we liked to go out with them. And, you know, it was just the paparazzi went completely crazy. So it was always a problem, because they just try to shove my date and his wife away and put us together. You know, I go, Julie, come here, you know, and I pull her in. This is wife now, you know, this is the real wife. I am the pretend wife.
As season after season of Dynasty wore on, the antics of the Carringtons and their cohorts got more and more outrageous. The show had strayed far from its roots, and the actors were not pleased. Forsythe especially let the producers and writers know that it was time to get back on track.
To do a show for 7 years on television is a treat. It's a very, very tricky thing to do. I think this, in our seventh year, is our key year. If we get back to where we were, conceivably this show could run another 2, 3, 4, 5 years.
Dynasty lasted for 9 seasons and 1 reunion movie. When it ended in 1989, John Forsythe was in his 70s. He now looked forward to spending more time with his wife and his horses. But John's retirement would be anything but sedate. As the greedy decade of the 1980s ended, so did John Forsythe's 9-year run as the avaricious Blake Carrington on Dynasty. With the show over, 72-year-old Forsythe thought that he was done with series TV. But when producer Norman Lear called and offered him a role in his new show, he couldn't resist. In The Powers That Be, Forsythe was cast against type as a bumbling United States senator.
Of the best broken field running anybody had ever seen.
Your time is up, Senator.
It is. Well, I didn't get to make my point. I have a point.
The program lasted only 1 season. The one role of Forsythe's that was never canceled was that of loving husband. He and Julie had now been married almost 50 years, a rare achievement in Hollywood.
Well, you know, this town has a reputation. I mean, people get married early in the morning in Hollywood, so if it doesn't work out, you don't kill a whole day. They were so wonderful together. I mean, they were just, they were like honeymooners after a million years of being married, you know.
They really were best friends. They did a lot of traveling together. And I remember that he would always get really annoyed with how many suitcases that she had. The packing was always an issue with the two of them, because she'd have all of this luggage, all of these bags, and he'd have to carry all of it. And he absolutely would go crazy. It was this same running argument that they would have every trip. And then she would be upset because he would wear a tie that didn't match his shirt. She thought he was colorblind. And so they'd have these same kind of recurring themes that would go on throughout their marriage. But they were wonderful together. They really were.
Then one summer afternoon in 1994, John and Julie's life together was shattered. Julie came in from working in the garden saying she felt tired. After lunch, she decided to take a nap. Later that afternoon, John tried to awaken his wife, but she didn't respond. In a panic, he called an ambulance. When Julie arrived at the hospital, she was put on life support. Doctors now told John that even if they could revive Julie, she would be in a vegetative state. Forsythe made the most wrenching decision of his life. He told doctors to take his wife off life support. Julie Forsythe died on August 15th, 1994.
For us, and especially for him, it was brutal. But I think he really coped within. I mean, I think it was internal and deep, and I think he's still not over the loss.
She was the light of the family. I mean, she really, she had a very cheerful spirit, and, you know, he's like the bricks and she's the mortar, and without them, without the other, the bricks are still standing, but definitely that foundation has been a little shaken.
Well, first of all, she was very beautiful. Julie had the biggest and most beautiful brown eyes that that were imaginable. And she was a talented woman, and a bright woman, and a good mother.
Forsythe has remained active since Julie's death, narrating documentaries, raising horses, and spending time with his family. He has always believed in balancing work and personal life.
I think that that acting is a wonderful profession, but life is an even better profession. And life is a thing that interests me more than just plain work.
After 50 years in show business, John Forsythe has more than proven his father wrong. He became a good actor and a successful one, and along the way, he earned the reputation as one of Hollywood's nice guys.
He's easy to be friends with. He's the sweetest, most lovable man. I mean, I know that's boring that everybody says the same thing. I wish I could tell you something bad about him. I've thought about it, but I can't find anything. Except he's tall. I hate that.
I'll tell you how nice he is. He had a bad knee, and he was looking to get a knee replacement. And I said, John, you know, I'm interested in hobbies and things. Would you mind very much if I replaced your knee? And he said, well, you know, what the heck? So I did, and it worked out pretty good for him. Only on damp days does he kind of go, gee, you know, it still bothers me a little bit. But he was so doggone nice, and no anesthesia, which was really unusual, because he just, we did it at the track.
He's just had such a long career, and I think it never got to be just work for him. I think every time he would start something new, he would approach it like he had never acted before, and he would get into it and bring out the character. He's just, oh God, we worked with so many actors. He's just one of the very special ones.